There were rumors for what seemed like forever. Then there was the unveiling at E3. Then there were the leaked screenshots from the reviewer's deck. But finally, the embargo is now up on the Fury X from AMD. It's time to see what kind of power this beautiful looking card is packing. Hit that like button for more videos featuring the Fury X. FreshBooks is the super simple invoicing solution that lets you get organized, save time, and get paid faster. Click now to try it for free. The Fury X measures in at 7.5 inches long. That's 30% smaller than a 290X, but length isn't everything. We joked about the 670 being a little bit less endowed than its brothers back in the day, but times have changed. People are looking for lots of power in a small package these days, and the Fury X is here to give. Featuring a Fiji core built on a 28 nanometer process, 4,096 stream processors, which is 1,280 more than a 290X, running at 1,050 megahertz, 256 texture units, 64 ROPs, GCN 1.2, along with 4 gigabytes of memory, which is a bit low for a card that costs $650 US, and a memory speed of 1 gigabyte per second, which is really low. So it has less RAM and at a lower speed than a 390X. What the f***? Moving on, it also has a 4096-bit memory interface. Whoa, hold on. That's 8 times that of a 290X, which is sitting at 512 bits. That results in the Fury X having a 512 gigabyte per second memory bandwidth, compared to the 290X's 320 gigabytes per second. Boom. Why is that? HBM, or High Bandwidth Memory. This is AMD's bet for the future direction of GPUs, and they've been working on it for 7 years. Their goal is to simplify PCB design and allow for smaller cards. Also, the pressure of potential stall of GPU performance growth always hangs. AMD states that historically we solved these problems by shrinking and integrating functions, and they would be right looking at the direction of motherboards and CPUs. How does it work for graphics cards? From the bottom up, AMD places a package substrate, an interposer right above that, then your GPU and a few logic dies for your memory. Stacked on top of those logic dies, you have your 4 HBM DRAM dies. Moving your memory so close to your GPU improves bandwidth per watt and allows for, as we've seen, extremely wide bus widths. But naturally, this is extremely new technology and is very expensive and difficult to produce, so you're paying an early adopter premium. Speaking of which, you cannot currently overclock HBM memory. You will likely be able to in the future, but as this tech is so freakishly new, they're probably just trying to play it safe. So that's paradigm shifting and awesome. Time to take a look at the rest of the card, however. For I/O, it's rocking 3 full-size DisplayPort 1.2s for our easy iFinity setup, since AMD requires all displays be plugged into a single card, and a single HDMI 1.4 plug. No HDMI 2.0, so you're limited to 30 Hz when running at 4K on HDMI, but, like, you've got 3 DisplayPorts. Just use one of those. And for all of you screen junkies, you can hook up to 6 displays into this thing, as long as you spring for a DisplayPort hub. Moving on to the rest of the exterior, you have a cool Radeon LED logo on the top, dual 8-pin PCIe power plugs on the right-hand side, which could theoretically support 375 watts, but won't really have to, as the typical load power of this card is 275. On the left-hand side features no crossfire fingers, as AMD continues their movement of connecting their multi-card configurations through the motherboard. On the back of the card, we have a nice full backplate, which is unfortunately interrupted by some various identification stickers. And just above where the power connectors are, we have the GPU TAC, or GPU tachometer, which is AMD's solution for load-based LEDs, and I have to say, I prefer it. I hate it when cards change RGB LEDs to signify load. No, I don't want my card to change color from white or green or red or whatever the hell just because it went a little bit faster. But having a GPU equivalent of the carnival game where you slam your hammer onto a platform and the meter goes up is totally cool with me. The front has another Radeon logo and a really nice looking finish where you can get a better look at the beautiful mixture of a mirror-like glossy black nickel aluminum finish, which I would complain about usually, but I think they implemented it pretty well here, and a black soft touch rubber, which feels as good as it looks. The bottom has an expected PCIe 3.0 16X slot, and the rear features some tubes and a power lead for the fan. You might also notice that it's sealed. On many cards, this area would be left open to allow for airflow, but much like the I/O plate and the rest of the card for that matter, it is a sealed enclosure, which is fine because there's no internal fan. Once you crack the card open, you reveal a tidy looking inside. A Cooler Master logo on the pump, and a very clever placement of a copper pipe in order to cool the VRM as the liquid travels on by. Leaving the card, we follow a nicely sleeved, appropriate length tubing and fan power cable setup to the radiator, which is a fairly standard 1x120mm setup with about 2.5 inches of thickness when measured with the included fan, which is appropriate as there is a little bit of hangover for what I believe is the included radiator. This unit also features a pretty legendary Nidec Gentle Typhoon fan, which will be running at a more tame than usual 1500 RPM in order to keep the noise down. All-in-one liquid cooling solutions on add-in cards has been a bit of a rarity, but it is definitely picking up speed. It makes sense to a lot of gamers to dedicate a potential radiator spot to your GPU, as pushing your CPU to the limit has had quite a reduction in impact in recent years, especially with Haswell and Broadwell dropping TDPs by another 20 watts. But the additional cost of including it from the OEM could be quite substantial, and you as the end user will have to pay for that. Let me know what you guys think in the comments down below, or over on the forum, or even on Twitter at Luke_LAFR. If this all sounds great to you, then you're in luck, because apparently there won't be any other versions of it from ASUS MSI or Sapphire, or because none of them will be allowed to customize the card. But if you do want a different feel, just wait for the R9 Fury, which should be coming around in July and will be able to be tinkered with by the add-in board partners, although it will be a bit slower. Stay tuned for our video on that card. Speaking of performance, I don't have as much to say as I normally do, as we were unfortunate enough to have our Fury X show up DOA with artifacting. But luckily, Scott Wasson from over at Tech Report had our back and supplied us with some graphs. We would both really appreciate it if you checked out his link in the video description down below to see his rundown and explanation of these numbers, including some more information like game settings and system specs. As far as I can glean from these charts, it's a relatively close race, but the 980 Ti still seems to win quite handily and happens to be the same price at $650 US. And once we get a replacement card from AMD, I'd love to take it for a spin and overclock the hell out of it to see if the story changes, however. If you want to see that, be sure to hit the like button down below again. In terms of power, this thing's pretty hungry. Scott's graph is under load of Crysis 3 at 4K, not peak performance, and the wattage noted here is full system usage, just so you know. Again, the link in the description down below for more information. In conclusion, the Fury didn't exactly rip NVIDIA apart and leave them in shreds like some people expected. It's short, and while we laughed at the 670, the market has changed, and I think we're ready for that now due to ITX motherboards and little tiny systems becoming the norm, and them wanting short little graphics cards. Just move the cooling to a single rad instead, and that could be kinda cool for a lot of people. GCN 1.2 means better DirectX 12 support than older generation AMD or older generation NVIDIA cards, and HBM is finally here, albeit a little lower of a capacity than we may have expected. Alright guys, I have something a little different for you now. Instead of a traditional ad spot for cable mod, we wanted to spice things up and do a build log of sorts of their new customizable ModFlex sleeved wires. Check it out.
I'm starting with this, actually, which is already done. So this is what your cable mod flex sleeved wires will actually turn into if you want to do it in this way. And then I will be doing silver and orange for the next one. So while you just check out these cables, I'm going to read off some facts about the mod flex wires. They're going to have a whole bunch of different connector types, 24-pin ATX, 8-pin EPS, 4-pin ATX, 6-pin PCIe, and 8-pin PCIe. In colors of blue, green, black, light blue, light green, orange, purple, red, silver, white, and yellow. And the lengths of the cables will be 20 centimeters, 40 centimeters, and 60 centimeters. So like I said, the idea is just kind of making your own cables. So, your connector will have a white dotted side and a side that has nothing on it. So that means that the white tips of these cables have to go into the end with the white dot. And then I have to pull these white ends off. So what I do is just use three of my fingers to kind of get all the way around it, shimmy it down a little bit, just so it gets over the metal piece. Then I can grab on the end and just pull it off. And just start putting things in. Boom, and done orange. Now, moving on to the gray one, we do pretty much the same thing. All right, so now we just go in the other holes. And it looks really good. So that was the white end. So what I can just do is plug this guy in. There we go. Now this is the black end. First thing that we actually need to do is get all these black tips off the end. So let's do that really quickly.
With like tunes or something.
So now we come around and just mirror the other side. There we go. You have yourself a nice and fancy, in this case, either silver and orange or black and green cable.
Whoa, my shirt's changed. Anyways, guys, I hope you liked the ModFlex DIY extension cables from Cable Mod, little weird build loggy kind of thing. I don't really know what to call it. It's an interesting form of an integration. I think it's pretty cool that you can make basically whatever color combination you want very easily. Making your own cables can be super annoying, so now you can make cool, like, multicolored cables all on your own within minutes. Anyways, guys, that's it. Thanks for watching, guys. If this video sucked, you know what to do. But if it was awesome, get subscribed, hit that like button, or even consider supporting us directly through using our Amazon affiliate code to shop at Amazon, buying a cool t-shirt, or even with a direct monthly contribution through the community forum. Now that you're done doing all that stuff, you're probably wondering what to watch next. So click the little button in the top right-hand corner to check out this video, where Linus and John from Techno Buffalo debate iOS and Android.